John 4:15 says, the woman said unto him, Sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come here to draw. And Jesus said unto her, Go and call your husband and come here. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. And Jesus said unto her, Thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that said thou truly. The woman said unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. And Jesus said unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship and ye know not what. We know what we worship, for our salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman said unto him, I know that Messiah is coming, which is called Christ. When he is come, he'll tell us all things. And Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Verse 23, the scripture said, Jesus said unto her, the Father seeketh such to worship him. I want to talk today about being sought out by God. Being sought out by God. Amen. Or should I say God is looking for you. Amen. In our text, and when I talk about God or the Father seeking, we want to first say seeking is not, you know, when we seek oftentimes, we're looking because we don't know where something is. But this seek is looking forward to, not looking far. Because God knows where each and every one of us are. And when I say he knows where you are, I don't mean he knows that you're sitting at 5416 Sun Valley Drive right now. But I mean, he knows where you are in your heart. He knows where you are in your walk with him. He knows where you are in your life. Don't forget in the book of Genesis when Adam had sinned. Bible said the Lord God came walking in the cool of the day and said unto him, Adam, where art thou? Don't you get it twisted and think that God couldn't find out. Amen. God knew where Adam was, but what God wanted Adam to know was where he was himself. Amen. Sometimes it's not a matter of God trying to find where we are. He wants us to see where we are. And a lot of times, because we live to our own selves, we try to figure life out and solve things ourselves. God wants us to see exactly what it looks like to him. Y'all ain't saying? Because sometimes to us, it looks like everything is just fine. Sometimes it looks like we got it all together. And yet God says to Adam, in the place where he put him, where are you? Amen. In our text, as the opening of this fourth chapter of the Gospel of St. John, the scripture gives that Jesus himself specifically said that he must needs go through Samaria, which would have been in and of itself a strange direction, a strange place to go, seeing that Jesus was a Jew and the Samaritans and the Jews didn't deal one with another. Well, the scriptures say the Jews thought that or considered the Samaritans, which were half-breed Jews, as being dogs, less than human. But Jesus says in his spirit that he must needs go through Samaria. I want to say too, because sometimes as we're on this walk with God, if we don't go to places that make the most sense. When God sends us and God gives us an assignment, sometimes if it's out of our comfort zone, or it's out of, away from folk that we're used to speaking to or dealing with, oftentimes we just simply fail the assignment. Jesus, being God in the flesh, said he must needs to go through Samaria. And the Bible said then that while in Samaria, his disciples had gone away to buy meat. And Jesus, being wearied from the journey, in other words, this was God in flesh, and the human part of Jesus succumbed to the tendencies that you and I have, and the Bible said he got tired. As a result, he sat on the well to get some rest. The scriptures say that while sitting there, a woman came to the well. And I want you to understand something. Now, this is about noon, the middle of the day. And the scripture said that when the woman came to draw water, Jesus said unto her, give me a little water to drink. The woman first said to him, well, first of all, you don't have nothing to draw with. And she marveled at the idea that Jesus, being a Jew and she being a Samaritan, would have conversation with her, have the audacity to ask her for water. How is it, she said, that you being a Jew would ask me for something to drink? The Jews don't have no dealings with the Samaritans. Some of us, you can see this as she speaks it, you know, in other words, now you need me. Not knowing who she was talking to, saying, now, in other words, you wouldn't have nothing to do with me if you didn't need me. And I want you to understand something. I don't care what God asks of you. God don't need us. We need God. Oh, don't ever misunderstand that, because sometimes we think we're doing God a favor. But whatever God asks of you, first of all, he will supply to you first to give. But secondly, God don't need nothing from you, not me. But the woman, not knowing who she was talking to, said to him, how do you even fix your mouth, in other words, to ask me for something to drink? The Bible said, Jesus said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it was that asked you for something to drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you the living water.
Hallelujah.
Woman said, well, you don't have nothing to even draw the water with, and the well is deep. And by the way, where do you get this living water from? She raised an interesting question. Are you greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Now, an interesting question that she would pose to Jesus, are you greater? Because sometimes our problem with submitting to God is that we think we have folk of we have resources that are greater than God. Y'all understand that? But I don't care who you have and what they have, eventually it's going to run out. Jacob gave us this well. This well is regarded as sacred to us. And are you supposedly better than him? Do you have some water better than this one? And Jesus simply said, whoever come and get water out this way, I'm going to have to come back tomorrow. You understand? They're going to become thirsty again. You understand? You're not going, no matter how much water you get out of the well or how much you drink today, you're going to get back thirsty just from drinking from this water. What Jesus was trying to say is, I got some water you can drink and you won't ever get thirsty.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
And we understand and come out of the woman's mind.
Yes.
You know, the scriptures say that a carnal mind is at enmity with God, and a carnal mind cannot interpret spiritual matters.
Amen.
Jesus speaking to a woman with a carnal worldly mind,
yes,
trying to offer her something spiritual.
Uh-huh.
And the woman says to him, where do you get this water from? And Jesus said, if you would just take a drink of this water, you won't never thirst no more. In other words, it's not that you won't have any more desires, but the water that you drink from the well, I don't care how much you drink, you're going to get back thirsty. Some of us, we can solve one thing, but we'll never solve everything. And Jesus is saying, I'm going to be to you what you need for everything. He can work out any situation that you ever get yourself in. We limit God. God is not limited. We simply limit God. So we feel God can handle a headache, but he can't handle cancer. We feel God can help us on our job, but he can't get us a job. We feel God can do something, but we limit God and what all God can do. What he's simply trying to tell the woman is that once you find him, you won't have to look for nobody else. See, some of us have to have 2-3 folks on standby in case one of them don't work out. Y'all understand that? Some of us have to play 2 or 3 folk in order to get 3 bills paid. Y'all better get this. And what he's saying is that if you get a hold of him, you don't need nothing else. So the woman still with a carnal mind saying, well, sir, give me this water so I don't get thirsty no more and don't have to come here to draw no more water. And I don't know, I want to point out something just briefly there. Again, this is the middle of the day. And only Jesus and the woman were at the well.
Yeah.
Typically in those days, you went to the well either early in the morning before you began your chores, or you came late in the evening to end your chores. But when we find out more about this woman, we can understand why she probably came to the well at the middle of the day and came by herself. Y'all ain't saying that. But they didn't have Facebook, and they didn't have email and text, and they didn't have telephones and television or news. So most news you got right there at the well. Folk met at the well and discussed current events, what was going on, and yes, even the latest gossip.
All right, now.
And this woman, undoubtedly being the subject of most gossip, decided that she would come to the well in the middle of the day. And let me tell you something else. When Jesus says, I must needs go through Samaria, he knew what he had to go to Samaria for. He knew who he was going to meet there. And he knew what time they needed to be there. And he knew what time he needed to be there. Sometimes we talk about coincidences and it just so happens. Ain't no coincidences. Ain't no just so happens. When God sets up a deal or when God orchestrates something, God knows when, where, and how to bless you. Now on our own, sometimes we mess it up. We get to fussing and cussing because we got stopped by the train. You understand that? But being stopped by the train is probably what kept you from the accident. Sometimes you don't know what God is doing. And just because it don't go the way you planned it, just because it's not all smooth sailing, doesn't mean that God is not trying to lead you and guide you. Now, engaged in conversation with the woman. When the woman showed interest in the water, even though it wasn't what she thought, Jesus simply says to her, go get your husband and come back.
All right.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And the woman answered and said to him, I don't have no husband. Jesus said, you well said that you don't have no husband. But just so you know that I know and understand, he said you done had five husbands who either ended in divorce or death. And the one that you have now, he says, is not your husband. And he says, in this you're truly sad. You know, sometimes when we can speak part truth just to keep folk from knowing stuff. You understand that? We hide stuff from one another, but God knows and God sees everything. So Jesus is now telling a woman who has never met him, who she's never heard of, all about what's going on in her life. So the woman says to him, I understand that you got to be a prophet. And this was some nervous stuff because if Gehazi, the servant of Elijah was here, he would tell you that Elijah had called him out when he went behind him and lied about it. Y'all ain't saying. In other words, she said that I've heard about prophets like this, and I understand that you got to be a prophet that you would know and tell me all about my life. But in order to not talk about what he wanted to talk about, she reminded me of some of us. She simply changed the subject. And she said, our fathers worship in this mountain. But y'all say that in Jerusalem is the place where men are worshiping. And basically what she was doing was offering Jesus an excuse for her not worshiping. Y'all ain't saying that. In other words, if I don't have to understand. Y'all telling me one thing and our father's telling me something else. So I don't know whether to worship here or there. There are folk just like that. Since I don't understand, since this religion don't make sense, since you can't answer questions, since you can't clarify things, I just put worshiping God on hold.
All right.
God has given us his written word.
Amen.
You know, I was at a funeral yesterday, and one of the ladies who got up to speak on behalf of the lady who had died, she was telling the people as she sat down, go to church and don't quit blaming the church. Quit blaming the preacher. Your walk ought to be between you and God. And I appreciate everybody every time they come to church, but you're not coming to church for me. You're coming for yourself and you're coming for God. I don't have a heaven or a hell to put you in. When I come, I'm trying to work myself out. I'm trying to make it myself. But sometimes we like to make all kinds of excuses. I hadn't said it in a while. Maybe you forgot. But when you stand before God, you're not going to remember my name. He's going to simply say, give an account of yourself. And whoever you're using for an excuse now, that's not going to work.
All right.
He's going to say, give an account of yourself.
Yes, sir.
The woman is saying, right now I can blame the Samaritans or the Jews since they can't make up their mind.
All right.
Since I don't know where to go, I just don't even worry about it. But you understand when you refrain from worship, when you refrain from giving God praise.
Yeah.
Anything and everything is subject to happen to you.
Amen.
Jesus said to her, believe me, the hour is coming.
Yeah.
You won't, this ain't going to be the designated place in this mountain, not in Jerusalem.
Yeah.
You won't worship the Father. He said, you don't worship, you worship and you don't even know what to worship. But we know what we worship. Salvation comes from Jews. And then he said, listen, let me tell you something. Some folk take this scripture to mean that you don't have to go to church.
My Lord,
you know what they say, the church is in your heart.
Uh-huh.
If the church is in your heart, You don't have to go, but you're going to want to go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. If you're saved and you got God in your heart, you're going to want to be around some saved folk. Amen. You're going to want to be around. It's refreshing. Yeah. Y'all ain't saying that. Yeah. After you work with folk who've tried to stab you in the back, after you have been around folk on the outside talking about you, lying on you, stealing from you, it's refreshing to come into the house of God with some like-minded folk who know that they need God just like you need it.
Man.
You must understand, though, that when you refrain from worshiping God, the devil has a field day with you. Sometimes it's because of disappointments in church. Sometimes it's because of disappointments with people, but have God disappointed you?
All right.
Is there any charge that you can bring against God? Did he not still wake you up every day? Did he leave you sleeping in the day of the week? Did he leave you hungry and outdoors in the day of the week? What charge can we lay against God that will cause us to not have a burning desire to worship him?
Amen.
But because of her lifestyle,
yes,
she was content to say, since I don't know where to worship,
all right.
I just won't worry about it. Let me tell you something about worship. That word comes from the root word worth. Value. And worship, as relates to God, ought to be based upon what he is worth to you. And I marvel at some folk who I have to say I've never seen worship. I've seen you at church, but I've never seen you worship. I've seen you singing, but I've never seen you worship. And worship means to love on God, to acknowledge God, to talk about his good, not your goodness, but his goodness, not to talk about how strong you are to be able to go through stuff, but how weak you were, and God showed his strength and brought you through. God wants us to worship.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
We have so long been content. We're trying to fill the church up.
Yeah.
Just want folk to come. Let them get their photo out for Facebook. You understand, on my way to worship. And it sounds good, but God wants somebody to come in and forget about themselves. Forget about what you got against somebody else. Forget about what's going on, what you left going on at home. But just come in and act like nobody in here but you. God wants us. And sometimes it's difficult to worship God. But if you could just think about not where you are necessarily, but where he brought you from.
Oh, yes.
What he brought you out of.
Amen.
And how he has kept you alive.
Thank you, God.
See, my thought is that no matter how bad it is right now, if I still got breath in my body, it can get better. My thought is, no matter what I lost, as long as that breath in my body, I can get another one. My thought is that God, who was able to give yesterday, is just as able to give on today. My thought is that as long as I'm alive, I still got a chance. Oh, well, I may be knocked down, but I thank God I'm not knocked out. As long as I got my being, as long as I got breath in my body. But God, he says, won't worship us.
Amen.
We come in church and we sing.
Yeah.
We give God what we call praise.
Yeah.
Praise is talking about the goodness.
Yeah.
We know how to praise one another, but we don't know how to praise God. We know how to sing, but there's no distinction between what you were singing last night and what you're singing today. You're just singing. Y'all understand that? But God wants us from our inner man, from the inner being, from our heart. God wants wants us to give him worship, wants us to line up with him. In other words, I can't feel it when I start out, but before I finish, I want to feel his presence. In other words, I don't want to come just to say I came, but I want to experience the presence. Singing won't really do nothing for you, just singing.
Amen.
All right.
But if you will line your heart up with God,
amen.
I don't come to worry about who's singing soprano.
Amen.
And who's singing alto.
Yeah.
And I know my voice might not hit nothing. Y'all ain't saying that.
All right.
But the book said, make a joyful noise to the Lord.
Amen.
And I'm glad that what's joyful to God may not be joyful to you. But he didn't say make a joyful noise to you or to one another. But he said make a joyful noise to the Lord. And I tell you what makes your noise joyful when your actions line up with your noise. Y'all ain't saying that. When you have obeyed the will of God. Says, the hour is coming.
Thank you.
Now is when you're going to need to worship God in this mountain, not in Jerusalem. But now is the time when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth. Father, the Father seeketh such to worship him.
Amen.
Otherwise, he's looking for some consistent worship.
Glory.
You know, some of us, our mind changes from 1 minute to the next.
Right.
But consistent worship said that he was good last week.
Yeah.
And he's still good this week.
Yeah.
Consistent worship said that I'm going to testify when I got a car.
Right.
And I'm going to testify when I'm walking. I'm going to worship him when I'm broken. I'm going to worship him when I got money. Consistent worship said, I don't take off when I'm going through. But when I'm going through, I want to go through with him. Y'all listen. I want God to help me go through. I don't go through by myself. If I can make it without him and go through, then I don't need him. But I understand that I need him.
Hallelujah. Amen.
I understand that.
Oh,
yeah. Without him, I'm nothing.
Amen.
And without him,
yes.
I could fail.
Hallelujah.
I need to point out something about the worshipers. He said, the Father seeketh such to worship him. Now, Jesus came to seek somebody.
All right.
But he didn't go inside the city.
Amen.
But there on the outskirts at the well, he waited for a woman.
Yes, yes.
Who he knew for Satan didn't have a holy life.
All right.
So then, who God is seeking for is not those who think they got it all together. For he said, hey, that a whole don't need no physician.
That's it.
But those who are sick.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that somebody in the town will have felt more worthy to worship God. But God's worship is not contingent upon how good you and I are. But his worship is because of how good he is. And even if you and I fall short, God is still worthy of worship. And I told you the devil's not going to get me two ways. Now he might get me to mess up. But just because I messed up, he's not going to pump me into not worshiping God. For God is all that I have. And all that I am is because of God. All that I ever could be is because of God. And the God that we serve is worthy of praise. But you know the devil will put in your mind sometimes that you done messed up so bad.
Yeah,
that you're not worthy to worship God.
Right.
twisted up in your mind. Because the worship and the worth belongs to God, not to you and I. In other words, we'll never be worthy of worship, but God is worthy of our worship. And he said, the Father seek as such. Seeks him to the extent to where if he has to isolate you, catch you all by yourself, he'll take every opportunity to just remind you to have a conversation with you, to remind you that he's seeking you to worship him. Sometimes, even in the midst of going to church every Sunday, we find ourselves still not worshiping God. You know, I have an appreciation for choir rehearsal, but I think in true worship, sometimes something ought to happen. Y'all ain't saying that we didn't go over in choir rehearsal. And in fact, something ought to happen even while we're in choir rehearsal, because practice makes perfect. If you're going to practice how to praise him, you ought to have some sincerity. You ought to have some truth. You ought to have some spirituality about you so that God can come in the room. Y'all ain't saying that. At our point of worship.
Hallelujah.
When you're getting real with God and get down to the nitty gritty, tell God I'm not worshiping for what you've already done. I'm not worshiping you because of what I have, but I'm worshiping him because he's worthy. And sometimes I see him worthy, not based on what he did for me, but sometimes based on what he did for you. I don't have to be healed of cancer in order to know that God is worthy. If I see where he healed your body, that's enough to give him praise. Don't I know for sure he's a healer and he's got power. And the same thing for you. Jesus, knowing all about the woman, still conversates with her. Still says to her that God is seeking for worship from you. And no matter what your background is, no matter what your past is, God is still seeking worship. You know, I marvel at how many church doors are open on Sunday. And I still see where folk are starting new churches every day. And every time somebody learns how to worship God, I mean become effective in worshiping, first thing happens is they get a CD. Y'all ain't saying that. They get on YouTube. And now, in order for them to worship God, somebody got to buy a ticket. Y'all ain't saying that. Somebody got to pay them to come and give God worship. Y'all better get this. Every time we get somebody who finds get worship right, the only way you can be in that presence, y'all ain't saying that. Somebody got to book them through that agent. Y'all better get this. Somebody got to pay some money in order for them to worship God. I come to tell you, once you put a price on it, it's not worshiping God. That's for you.
All right, now. Amen.
Every time we boast about how anointed they are.
Yeah. Amen. Say it.
Amen. How real they are.
Yeah.
Know anything? Nah, it ain't about God.
All right.
But it's about them.
Yeah.
Y'all better get this. And so then those who would appear to be true worshipers now seeking fortune and fame. And in this church, when we come in church, we don't have nobody who want to say, just forget about me and how good you said my voice sound. I just praise and worship the Lord. He said, this is what God is seeking. And I think about when Jesus was on his earthly ministry. On a number of occasions, the Bible said that people came to him seeking something, one favor or one blessing or another. And when they came to him, they came worshiping him. And we won't even worship him when we're in need of him. Y'all ain't saying we begin to think that God owes us something. You just high five enough folks. You just listen to the right preacher that God is going to automatically bless you. But the Bible said that when the mother of James and John came up to Jesus one day, the scripture said they came worshiping him. And Jesus knew from the outset that she came desiring something. And the scripture said, though, that she had the decency and the intelligence to know that he was worthy of praise and worship. Your worship should not be contingent upon how good you feel. For you don't have to feel good to worship God. Even if you don't have no hands to hold up, still worship God. If your voice has been muted and you can't make no sound, y'all ain't saying that, you can still worship God. This is why he said God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. It's hard to worship God when you got all kind of stuff on your mind. It's hard, I said, to worship God when all kind of stuff is in your heart. It's hard to worship God when you've been playing around with the devil all week long. It's hard to worship God when everything around you has started to cave in. But if you could put it out your mind, if you could just forget about it, if you could just think about it, in your right mind, how he started you on your very way. You ought to be able to worship the Lord. Maybe no sound won't come out, but something on the inside ought to line up with the Spirit of God. You ought to tell the Lord, Father, I'm sorry for all when you're not real. You ought to be real with God. Be real. with yourself and be real with other people. And when it comes time, every chance you get, not just on Sunday morning, you ought to worship God. You ought to just tell God how much you adore him, how much you think of him, how much you appreciate him. Now,
yeah.
I hear folk talking about the holiday blues.
All right. Well,
I can't buy what I want.
My Lord.
I can't get this. I don't have that. Very occasion we ought to be celebrating.
Yeah.
Was designed for grown folk and not children.
All right. All right. All right.
Somebody's still saying, I ain't gonna ruin it for my children.
Uh-huh.
You understand that? The devil takes everything that God gives us and he finds a way to take it away from us. Y'all ain't saying that. Everything that God gives us that's supposed to bring us joy, the devil has a way of making it bring us up. As children, they taught us a song that said, joy to the world.
Yes.
They used to let you sing it in school.
The
Lord has come.
Yes.
Let earth receive her King.
Yeah.
Let every heart prepare him room. And let heaven and nature sing.
Amen.
Now, it's just about what we can buy. And I even hear folks saying, Christmas ain't nothing to me. That's just for the cheer. But if you don't tell your children what it's really about, if you don't tell them how the world was lost and doomed for hell, but one Christmas morning, Christ was born, you but the God I say got a bird out to you. He sees us when we're right.
Amen.
He sees us when we're wrong.
Oh, yeah.
Yet he loves us. Yet he seeks us. He's still looking for somebody to say, I didn't get it last week. I didn't worship last week. But for God I live and for God I die. Somebody ought to realize you cannot make it without him. And you won't make it pleasing in preacher. You won't make it pleasing people. But God is.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
He's the only give and take of life.
Yeah.
The only one who can save your soul.
Amen.
The only one who can keep you out of hell's fire. The only one who can deliver you from drugs and alcohol. The only one who can deliver you from sin. We worship everything but God. He said the Father seeks such to worship him. God is a spirit. Because we can't see him. Because we can't see the Spirit. We want to deal with what we can see. We want to lash out at what we can see. We want to blame what we can see. But I want to tell you, make sure and very sure that you have done your best. Y'all ain't saying that. Make sure and very sure that God can't blame you. Make sure that somebody can't blame you. For God is a faithful God. Even when it look like it's all over.
Yeah.
When it looks like we count it out.
Yeah.
When it looks like we done lost everything.
Yeah.
You would worship him.
Boy, yes.
In spirit and truth.
Amen.
I'm through, but the Bible says, hallelujah. The Bible says, the God told the prophet to go tell King Hezekiah to set his house in order because he gonna die and not live.
Amen.
The scripture said that he didn't do like some of us
and
say you only live once.
Amen.
I might well party on my way out.
Yes.
But the Bible said he turned his face to the wall.
Amen.
And began to worship God. Yeah, turning your face to the wall means taking your face out of somebody else's face. If you really want God to bless you, you gotta get other folk out your ear. Get other folk out your face. Quit trying to blame other folk and just submit yourself to God. You need this time. You need this time. You need this time. You need this time to turn your face to the wall. To tune out everything and tune out everybody. Sometimes you gotta turn off Facebook. Sometimes you gotta turn off the telephone. Sometimes you gotta turn off the television and turn your face to God. Something for folk.
Yeah.
No matter how big or how small. And they don't say thank you. If it's a child, you reach for it back and say, what you gonna say?
Because
you really, really think that you deserve some great thanks. For your stale vanilla wafer. Y'all ain't so. You really think you deserve some praise for whatever you did for somebody else. And here God don't walk you up. And if nobody had no mention it to you, you wouldn't even tell him thank you. With my eyes come open, my mouth come open to me. Somebody wrong, and they don't tell you thank you. You just conclude it's too late to teach you. But I bet I ain't gonna do nothing. But I bet I ain't gonna do nothing else for you. You ain't saying that because you can't say thank you. Just imagine for a moment. If God was like that.
Thank you, Lord.
Did you hear that? Just imagine for a moment. When you think of all he's done for you. I'm not just talking about material things. When you were walking, I was with my son the other day, but he was getting ready to go to surgery on his eye. And we were sitting in the eye doctor, and I saw another man that was legally blind getting ready to have surgery also. And I looked down as the man was sitting, and the man had an artificial leg. And I don't care where you are, you always find somebody who will worse off than you. You're out here moping about what you don't have. You're out here moping about who didn't call you. You're out here moping about what they wouldn't do.
All right.
And he'll be a little God. God, yeah. You'd rather please people than to please a living God. He's seeking folk to worship, not to join the church, not to be in the choir, not to preach. He's seeking folk to simply worship.
Thank you.
Did you hear what I said? He's seeking folk who can come to realize that he's worthy.
Yes.
Thank you.
Now we quit trying to think that we're worth so much. We can recognize the worth of God. The Bible says, in our weakness, he's made strong. Nothing in this place is about me, and nothing in here is about you. It's all about God. And all of us ought to be striving to get that relationship with God that's of such that even if I get out of bounds, even if I step out of line, God know of a surety that I love him above all else. Y'all better get it. Sometimes you can be in love with somebody and still mess up. Y'all better get it. And God can understand when you got a healthy relationship with him. But to continue and make excuses why I won't commit myself. Continue to make excuses why I want to be halfway out and halfway in. I just want to be in enough to, for somebody to say I'm in. I don't care how many funerals you go through and how many folk they tell you got there.
Amen.
Every one of us
are
going to have to stand before God.
Amen. Amen.
Now some folk are already dead, I know that, but the scripture says that even the dead will be raised from the dead to give them account of the deeds that were done in their body.
Amen.
All of us are going to have to stand before God. And I'd rather, you know, now I have to introduce myself. I'd rather have that relationship so that, you know, when you know somebody, you know I'm real good, and other folk are expecting some kind of formal thing, and God just said, hey, how's it going? Come on now.
Hallelujah.
See, I want to have a pleasant talk with God. I don't want to be trying to scramble and explain to God why I wouldn't worship, why I wouldn't come to, why I wouldn't commit myself to. All excuses will have done away with. You won't be able to say, I didn't have no lamb to sacrifice. You won't be able to say, I couldn't get to the temple. You won't even be able to say, I never heard your word. You won't be able to say, I didn't know. I serve you notice. Everybody here right now already know enough to know that God is real. God desires worship. He's seeking true worship. And he's coming back one day. I don't know if he's coming back, but the promise is he's coming back. And every promise God has ever made, he either has already fulfilled it, or you best believe he's going to fulfill it. He's coming back just like he said he would. God bless you and God keep you. There's anybody in here today who has shunned the very idea of giving God worship.
Amen.
Somebody who want a new perspective, a new outlook, a new way of seeing God.
Thank you, Lord.
Today is a good day.
Amen.
It's a good time to come and say, for God I live and for God I die.
Amen.
God wants true worship.
Yes.
Somebody who will give in their time, give in their money.